Hey everyone, how you doing? It's April, beginning of April, 2017, and I finally finished my Hudson Bay axe. It's been an axe I've been looking for quite a while. I know you can buy them new online from different manufacturers and stuff like that, but I was really looking for something that was old, antique. I really like restoring axes and stuff like that. So it took me a while to find one that was in my price range kind of thing. And then, of course, the shape too. You know, you don't want it in too rough a shape. So anyways, this is it. This is how it kind of turned out. I'll just talk a little bit about what I did. I'll take the sheath off it for now. When I got it, it had a really, like a brown patina on it, and it was really, really nice. But whoever owned it before me, there was a lot of damage done up here. They took it to a grinder or something like that and did a lot of damage, so I had to sand this down quite a bit to get some of the deep grooves and stuff out of it, and the whole time try not to wreck the temper while doing so. And I was successful, but it took a lot of work. And I was kind of a little disappointed that I couldn't have kept that brown patina. But, you know, sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. So, you know, it's not that big of a deal. But I still like the way it turned out. I think the head of it might weigh, you know, and somebody else, you know, somebody else out there that has one might know. But it feels like it's about, you know, 1.5, 2 pounds kind of thing, maybe. So it's a nice axe, and I'll try and add a picture. There's the handle that came on it was just a 16 inch handle, and you could tell this axe was really, really loved, you know. It had a big split down the handle and stuff like that. It was taped up with some duct tape, so I had to remove it. There's no way of keeping it, and I decided, you know, obviously I'm going to have to put my own handle on it. And I've been having a lot of trouble finding good hickory. I still keeping my eye out, but when I was at the wood place, they had some canary wood that was on sale. And when I looked at it, I love the grain of it. Like, it was such a beautiful wood. I've never worked with it before, and it was just a beautiful, beautiful grain wood. And I thought, you know, I'm just going to give it a shot. You know, I felt it. It kind of had that density of a good hardwood, and so I brought it home and had it for quite a while. And then when I got this head, I decided, you know, I'm just going to try it. You know, and I'll show it to you here a little more closely. I just want to point out, though, when I made this handle, I made a pattern first, because I don't know anything about this wood. Looking at the grain, you know, it's all wrong when you're thinking axe handle. But I made a pattern, thinking, you know, if or when this breaks, I'll have a pattern at least. If the handle's no good, if I can't get the pattern out of the handle, then I'll have the pattern that I made originally. And anyways, there'd be a few changes that I would make to it, I think. But anyways, this is the wood, and like I said, I think it's just beautiful. All the different colors all the different colors in it. I've just put boiled linseed oil on this, and before I did that, there was red streaks in it. There was purple, and there was even a bit of green mixed with the bright yellows and the off color yellows. Like I said, it's just a beautiful wood with a lot of color and a really nice grain pattern. And to be honest with you, I don't think I've ever worked with a nicer wood to work with for shaping, sanding, just all around, you know, cutting the wood and stuff like that. It works really, really nice. It smells terrible. it kind of has like a, you know right off the bat that it's an exotic wood, and it's from Brazil, I think I read. I had to look it up after. But anyways, this is how it turned out. And if you look, you can see how the grain kind of runs off and curves back around and stuff like that. But, you know, to me, when I do a handle, you know, this isn't much for me to do. I work with wood quite a bit, you know. It's not really much. Like, if this did break, then whatever. I'll just go back and make another handle for it, you know, out of something else. So, you know, I'm never, I wouldn't be happy, but, you know. Anyways, so this is it. I put a 20-inch handle on this. Like I said, the first one was 16 inches. And, you know, I don't mind a 16-inch hatchet, but, you know, I think 19, 20 inches is more practical, especially like if you're doing bushcraft and things like that. So I decided I would just try and put a 20-inch handle on it, and, you know, this is how it kind of turned out. And I'm happy, you know. You can see the old, like if you look here, you can see all like the, whether that's hammer marks or forging marks. When they forged it, they're on the bottom too, so it almost tells me that could be forged hammered marks, because why would you be beating on that part of the axe? But I don't know. The pole was mushroomed quite a bit on it when I got it, so as soon as I saw that, when I see a pole that's really been beat on by obviously steel, the one of the first things I check is down in here. On each side, I look for cracks that run up this way, because, and then cracks back here on the weakest corners of the head. Just when I see that somebody's been pounding on it pretty hard, that's what I look for, because I figure I've seen it before. That's where the metal is the weakest, and then that's where it cracks. This was in really good shape. It's very strong. If you can see the. When I mounted this, when I mounted the head to the axe, or hung the head on the axe, the eye of the axe doesn't run true to the top part. So, a lot of people will tell you, like, if it's off a little bit, it doesn't really make that much of a difference. But, you know, since I was doing the handle anyways and hanging it myself, I just accounted for that when I was doing my when I was doing the handle. I just kind of offset the handle, sort of, so it runs true. Now the center of this runs true to the center of the axe handle. And if I have to make another handle again, I'll just do the same thing. But yeah, I'm happy. I finally got one. I think it turned out pretty good. I would love it if this handle could last. You know, I haven't really used it too much, and. I'm gonna wait till the warmer weather. It's still a little bit of winter here in Canada, and I don't really feel like going and hammering it into some still frozen wood and stuff like that. So, you know, I'll wait till the summer or later on in the spring to get it out and try it. But no, like I said, I'm happy. You know, it's been something I've been after for quite a while, and you know, it feels good to finally have gotten one. I made the sheath for it. Just a simple sheath. You know, you would see it on any Weatherlings or Granford's Brooks kind of axe. So I just did a little bit of just kind of made it a little more flashy, sort of. I put a nicer snap cap, I guess you'd say, on here. And then on the back, I just kind of added that. That's another one of those Chicago kind of bolts that swivel. I just put it on just because I like to make things kind of look good and look a little different than doing the same thing over and over again. And yeah, so that's about it. And like I said, I'm happy. I'm happy with the way it turned out. And Hopefully it lasts for a while. If not, well, maybe by then I'll have run into some good hickory or something like that. And if I can't, well then, you know, I can get my hands on some ash, so I will I'll end up just making a handle out of ash or something like that. Not really a big deal to me. I didn't put a wedge in the head. I didn't feel it needed one yet. I see a lot of people that'll make an axe, and then they'll set the head, they'll do a really good job, and then right off the bat they just take a wedge and hammer a wedge in, and I, you know, I guess to each is their own. I just thought, you know, if you do a good job on hanging the head, you don't really need the wedge yet until maybe a couple years later the head starts to come loose, or the wood shrinks or something like that, then you have the option of putting a wedge in. I see a lot of people that will do a whole axe, and as soon as they're done, drive a wedge in it. And you know, maybe sometimes it's they didn't get it quite tight enough or whatever. And you know, I think that maybe just comes with experience. The more you do, the better at it you get. So on this one, it went well. It had a nice it set really nice. I've still actually left the burrs that it creates as the head's coming down on it. I haven't trimmed it up at all, and like I said, I just felt there's no need yet to put a wedge in it. If you don't have to, I say don't do it until you have to. And in fact, I carry a wedge with me in my kit. You know, if I'm out bushcrafting or stuff like that, I just have a wedge that I've just thrown in my bag somewhere. If need be, if I needed to put a wedge in, I could probably do so now. You know, some people might say, well, you need a hammer to put it in. Well, you know, we'd have to just improvise. If it was that dire of a situation, you know, you pick a rock up and you hammer it in, you know, you do something. But like I said, I don't always put one in unless I feel like I didn't get a really good set on the head, so then I would. But anyways, that's it, and I'm proud of it. I like the way it turned out. The color, it's beautiful. I have more of this wood. I would like to put it on a knife handle. I certainly will be doing more with this wood, because it's so easy to work with. It's called canary wood, and it does have a few other names, but canary wood seems to be the most used. Just holding it here in the light now, I can see the red coming through. So like I said, it's beautiful. I just love the way it looks. And anyways, yeah. So I finally got one, and I finally got it done. I'm happy. So there was something else too I wanted to show you. It's not really that big of a deal. I'll take it off here actually. I made this well, it's a couple years old now, has to be anyways. And somebody might say it's overkill. I do struggle with sometimes when I'm making stuff, I tend to keep going. I'll go overboard on a lot of things, and sometimes I need somebody to pull the reins back on me. This is nothing more than just a leather case, and it locks in place by this kind of a fancy little thing that I came up with. I actually came up with this design because I had no idea of a different way to do it that made it look nice. So this is just how it turned out. That's what holds it in. So you undo that little strap of leather there, and then pull the whole thing up. On the back here, it has two snaps that you can snap it onto your belt or onto your bag or whatever, and pull it out. And I didn't, I'm not going to take credit for this, because I certainly didn't come up with it. And whoever did out there, there's been lots of them done. I'm just going to clean it up a bit. What? That was weird. And That's strange. Can you hear that? Anyways, it's a magnifying glass wrapped in leather, and I've seen lots of them. I forget where I first saw one. Just on. Seriously? I have no idea what that is. I've never actually heard that before. It's nothing more than leather just wrapped around a magnifying glass, and then I stitched it. I put this, you can wear it around your head if you want, like, you know, if you want to, if you have it out, you don't want to put it right back in your thing. Maybe you're waiting on the sun to come back. It went behind a cloud and you were using it. But, yeah, so I just kind of sewed it, put a little couple nicks in it. So when you can just tie it back up or wrap it back up again and then slide it back in the sheath. But, you know, I haven't used it too much. I've started a few fires with some light tinder and stuff like that, you know. But to be honest with you, I used to smoke cigarettes, and I found myself lighting the end of my cigarette with it. And I know that's terrible, but I don't smoke anymore. So like I said, it's been sitting in my dresser for a while, and I just thought, you know, I saw it there the other day, and I thought, you know, maybe I'll bring it out and I'll just kind of throw it into this video. And yeah, I kind of like it. I like to make things a little fancy, you know. I know everybody says, you know, all you need it to do is work, but I like it. I like to make things kind of look cool. It's as simple as that. So, and I've had a. Sorry, excuse me, I'll just put this in. I've had a couple people comment on, ask me about this shirt, and I never really expected anybody would really comment on it at all, but I didn't buy it anywhere, I made it. It was a painter's drop cloth that I had one time, and it was an experiment. I wanted to make a bush shirt kind of thing, something really light. But then I wanted to waterproof it, and I tried the whole boiled linseed oil and mineral spirits and stuff like that, and the whole mixture, and it just the smell of it, it kind of stunk so bad. So I've tried my best to take out all the by washing it, and you know, it was a lot of work to try and get that back out. Right now it doesn't really smell at all. But like I said, it's just a painter's drop cloth, done to the best of my poor sewing ability. I haven't even finished the cuffs. I've left them really long. I didn't know if it was going to shrink or what. Just left them long and figured I would just sew them up. So yeah, this is it. It has a collar that I just folded down, and on the back of the collar you can see where you can just pull it and tighten it up around your neck just to stop that kind of cold air from going in. And when I don't need it, I just roll it down, flip it over on itself, so it just kind of opens it up a little bit more. And I put a hood on it. It's just a small hood, like I said, just to kind of keep the wind from hitting the back of your neck or whatever, you know. And yeah, nothing more than a simple painter's drop cloth, and you know, a little bit of time on the sewing machine, and I threw a pocket on the front of it just for the hell of it, you know, in case I want to put something in there. That's about it. Like I said, my lines are all crooked and stuff like that, but you know, I don't care about things like that when I'm sewing, you know. Just as long as it gets put together and it holds, that's all I care about, really, you know. I dyed it a couple times, so it kind of has this blotchy kind of look to it. But I thought about dyeing it again another time and making it really dark or something like that. But then I thought, the hell with it. I'm just gonna leave it the way it is, and it is what it is, you know. So that's about it. Like I said, I just wanted to show you this. I maybe I'll mention too, I was looking at axes and stuff like that online, and I had I've always admired the Wetterling's Hudson Bay axe, and it was a really expensive axe, you know, and I always said that at some day that I would spend the money on that axe, you know, if I had to spend some money on an axe, that would be the axe that I would want, you know, the Wetterling's Hudson Bay. So I was watching a couple of videos, and there's not too many videos on YouTube about the Wetterling's Hudson Bay axe. There's a couple of videos. They're French. I still watch them anyways because I just wanted to see the axe, and I wish I could understand it, because the guy that does the axe reviews in French or whatever, you know, I'd really like to watch his channel, or you know, at least understand what he's saying. But it looks like he does good videos. But anyways, so I was looking at this this video, and oh darn it, I can't remember his name. He's another Canadian bushcrafter. I'll try and remember his channel. I have it saved anyways. I subscribed to him. I was watching his video. He did a review on it, and anyways, I made a little comment at the bottom, and then he commented back about the axe, and he said that the Wetterling's company was like ending, like that's it, and I thought, what, you know? So I asked a few people, and then did my own little bit of research, and to my surprise, yeah, they're ending. They're either collaborating with Gransford's Brooks, and they'll work underneath them, but no more Wetterling's. And then when I heard that, that scared me. I thought, holy jumping thing, I'm gonna miss my chance to get that axe. You know, if I don't act now, then I'm not gonna act. I went over to Bushcraft Canada and checked his site. He had no more axes available, Hudson Bay axes. So I went to another Canadian site, and they had them in stock or whatever. So, you know, I talked to the wife, you know, and she kind of understood. She seen my reaction when I told her, like, you know, the company's done. I don't know if they'll continue to make this axe under the name of Gransford's Brooks. So she said, you know what, just go ahead and do it. So I said, yeah, like, I kind of feel like I have to. And it was nice of her. She said that she'd pay for half of it for me. So it's expensive. I would never, yeah, I wouldn't want to pay this much for an axe. I'm paying half of it, so it's $100. She's paying $100. Here in Canada, it was about $205, said and done. So really, really expensive axe. But you know, now if there is no more Wetterling's company, to me, it seems like it's a little more special now. A little bit of a piece of history, I guess you'd say, you know. So I was a little disappointed to hear that, but I guess now I have an expensive axe coming. It'll be my first expensive axe, you know. I've always promoted, you know, try and make your own and stuff like that, but you know, this was just something special to me, you know, to own an axe like that, to buy that company. And so I went ahead, and I guess it's on its way. So anyways, I don't know if you're getting tired of these axe videos or not, but it just seems like once you start one, you go around. I found another one, you know. I got another axe. It's a Canadian company. I'm gonna restore it too. It's a full-size axe. It's 36 inch handle on it, single bit, and it's made by Walters. It's a Canadian company out of Quebec that are no longer in business. I think they were running for 130 years, I could be wrong, but a really long time, and it was passed down and stuff like that, father to son. And so that, to me, that's a piece of Canadian history as well. And I already have one of their hatchets. I found this one, and I'm gonna restore it too. So when I get that one done, I'll show it to you guys. Anyways, I'm just gonna have a little fire here, make a coffee, and relax for the rest of the afternoon, I think. And I appreciate you watching. Thanks for your time.